Welcome to the Mondrian exhibition in the National Gallery of Ireland. This is an audio-described tour. In the next 20 minutes, we will explore five key works in this exhibition. Each work will be described in detail, including their setting in the room and the frame in which they are displayed. If you would like to know more about the overall history of Piet Mondrian, 1872 to 1944, and his career, you can visit the gallery's website. This exhibition is divided into five rooms, each with its own theme, moving from Mondrian's early landscapes to his later, more well-known abstract pieces. The five rooms connect through one long passageway without any doors. You will enter the first room through an automatic door positioned in one corner of the room. Please turn to your right and make your way across the room. The first work we will be describing is on the left of this long wall. This first room focuses on Mondrian's early work. It has dark blue walls which complement Mondrian's naturalistic paintings and landscapes. The gine, trees along the water, is one of his more naturalistic landscapes. It is a rectangular oil on canvas measuring approximately 73 centimetres across by 53 centimetres down. It hangs in a slim, simple wooden frame. The flat of the frame has an off-white wash, while the thin, slanted internal moulding is painted a peachy brown colour. The overall atmosphere of the painting has a soft, low light. The brushwork appears unfinished and fast at first, however, there are several layers of paint on the canvas. You can still get a sense of the texture of the canvas through the paint. The overall composition of the painting is broken into three horizontal parts, which we will look at from the top of the canvas down. The top is predominantly blue skies with pink, white and grey clouds. The middle portion consists of 11 tall trees, which slightly trail off into the distance on the left. They have thin, spindly trunks. Most of them appear to be one stroke of a brush. The leaves and branches are undefined and all blur into one another. On the left, there are two smaller trees with shorter trunks and round, bushy branches. These appear to be in the distance. All the trees stand on a bright green embankment of grass that runs the length of the painting. The lowest third of the canvas is the reflection of the embankment, trees and sky in a very still river, most likely the gine. We now make our way from this long wall to the left into the next room, which has a grey stone colour on the walls. When facing into the space with our back to the long wall, the work we will focus on is to your right. It is Mill at Domburg, the left-hand work of the two hanging here. This oil painting is actually on cardboard rather than canvas. It therefore has a smoother surface than the previous work. It measures approximately 76 centimetres by 63 centimetres. The frame is a thin, simple design painted with light cream gloss. While this is a landscape of a windmill, it is actually in a portrait layout with long sides and narrow top and bottom. Like the previous work, this has a rough, unfinished appearance while having several layers of paint. However, in this case, some of the layers are lighter and show previous base layers beneath. Mondrian has signed the bottom right corner of the painting with his first and last name. Most of the landscape focuses on a windmill set slightly to the right of centre. The viewer is positioned below the windmill, so it looms large in the frame. The shape of the windmill appears as a silhouette painted in blues and purples with a faint outline in burnt orange. We, the viewer, are standing to the side of the mill, viewing it as if in profile, so the large rotating blades are facing the right of the painting. The silhouette of the windmill bleeds down into the land beneath, as the blue and purple paint covers an oval shape on the ground. In the foreground, the edge of the oval has a bright orange outline. In the foreground, there are a series of light blue and teal brushstrokes on a background of oranges and pinks, marking the land beyond the shadow of the windmill. The sky behind the windmill has swirls of thick, square, soft blue brushstrokes. They create a sense of wind high in the clouds. On the left, near the horizon line, there is a small swirl of yellow and orange, giving the impression of a sunrise or sunset in the distance. To move to the next room, please make your way to the right along this wall into the next space, moving left. Our next work is on the centre wall. It is the third painting on the right. This room is an off-white colour and focuses on Mondrian's cubist works, which often appear more abstract. This work, called Composition Trees 2, is an oil on canvas. The framing around the painting is slightly more elaborate than the previous works. A thin, dark wooden frame surrounds the canvas. This first frame and the canvas are on a white mount encased in glass with a deep-set white box frame. The canvas is almost a metre in height and just over half a metre wide. However, the framing adds roughly 40 centimetres on each side. This work is a step closer to Mondrian's more well-known abstract works. It has a mostly grey palette and depicts a deconstructed group of bare trees. There is a roughly painted black outline with curved corners around the edge of the entire canvas. Mondrian has signed the bottom right corner with just his surname. In this work, he has left some bare canvas, which gives a sense of depth, particularly with sections around the bottom and edges, which appear unfinished. There are overlapping brushstrokes creating around 100 small geometric shapes marked by black and brown lines. Most of these lines are straight, apart from a few curved lines in the centre that seem to have been painted on earlier layers. Some lines are thicker than others, bringing out a clearer outline of tree trunks and branches in the centre of the canvas. Grey paint of various shades fills in the geometric shapes, creating depth and variety. As you turn around and make your way into the fourth space through the passageway on the left, you will find the next piece slightly to the right in the centre of the room. It is an armchair designed by Thijs Rinsema. It is approximately a metre high and 3/4 of a metre wide and deep. It has been placed on a slightly raised white plinth. This room is the same light grey as the last room, and the chair is lit by spotlights. This piece of furniture consists of a series of rectangular wooden supports and flat wooden panels. The front two legs are short and black, stopping at the seat of the chair, while the black back legs run halfway up the back of the chair. There are three thinner white supports on the left, right, and rear of the chair that sit low beneath the four legs. The white support at the front is higher and closer to the seat panel. The thin black rectangular seat panel tilts from the front of the chair, where there are a few scuff marks, dipping down into the back. It sits on a frame of white supports that connects the legs and the arms of the chair. Black armrests run from the previously mentioned higher back legs to the front of the chair, like a flat, solid shelf from one side along the back to the other side. The chair's back, a narrow, thin red back panel, appears to rest against the armrest shelf. The back of this red panel is white with a small black cataloguing sticker in the top right corner saying MH1-1963. The panel has raised points at the top left and right corners. Beneath the armrest shelf is a strip of red panel that runs parallel to the armrest itself. The overall appearance is of a chair with clean lines that is both solid and light. Please move to the right through the long passageway and into the last room. In the final space, which is painted the same darker grey as the second room, all the works focus on Mondrian's later career and his purely abstract forms. The work we will discuss in this room is in the middle of the centre wall. It is less than a metre high and slightly over half a metre wide, meaning it is a rectangle in portrait format. The frame is similar to the third painting in that the work is set in a box frame. The canvas has a very thin 2 centimetre off-white frame. However, the painting seems like it is floating out of the frame, meaning the frame is recessed slightly. The frame and the canvas sit in a white wooden box with glass and a white mount. The box frame adds roughly 30 centimetres on all sides. The overall composition consists of 19 squares and rectangles filling the canvas. A thick black line separates each square or rectangle. Some sit horizontally and others vertically, creating a jigsaw puzzle style appearance. The overall composition of this work, titled Composition with Red, Black, Yellow, Blue and Grey, consists of 19 squares and rectangles filling the canvas. A thick black line separates each square or rectangle. Some sit horizontally and others vertically, creating a jigsaw puzzle style appearance. There are 2 red rectangles in the top left corner, a strong blue square in the bottom left corner, and a yellow rectangle along the right side of the canvas. 4 white rectangles are grouped together slightly to the right of centre, with 2 side by side vertically on top of the other 2 resting horizontally. 4 more rectangles at the edges of this white grouping are very pale blue. 1 is at the base of the white group, the 2nd halfway down the left of the group, and the 3rd and 4th form the top right corner of the canvas, fitting between the corner of the white group and the edge of the frame. In the bottom right corner, there is a small black rectangle. Between this and the pale blue rectangles in the top right corner is the long, slim yellow rectangle. To the left of the pale blue corner is a large black horizontal rectangle. It does not touch the edge of the canvas, as there is a very thin sliver of light blue at the edge. From the top left corner, the 2 thin red rectangles run until halfway down the canvas. Beneath this, there are 3 light blue rectangles and the strong blue square arranged to make up most of the bottom left corner of the canvas. Just left of centre at the bottom of the canvas, Mondrian signed this work with his initials and the year, PM 21.